All right, so this video is a shout out to John Lung, another Mythbusters candidate that wanted to see the shop. And so this is the shop that I'm currently moving into and doing a lot of stuff. I've done all the electrical from 220 to three phase. Also putting in LED lighting, so we're in the middle of that. So clutter everywhere, but let's give it a quick tour. So first thing you'll notice is there's this giant mezzanine here. So that mezzanine basically adds 400 square feet of shop space. So you can kind of see both up level and down level. So let's head up to the mezzanine first. So check this out. First thing, we got a nice little lounge chair in case you want to kick back. And we have flat screen TV you can watch. So this I built with a surround sound stereo system, built-in DVD player. And then it's all framed in Purple Heart wood. And then, so got a lot of stuff from some cutting torch motors, blah, 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 inverters. Actually have suction cups in those to climb a building or change glass. And then down here is a lot of my aircraft sheet metal work. So a bunch of these big old smash rivet guns. So there's the D gun. And the big G gun to smash the rivets. A bunch of Clecos so we can hold our sheet metal in place. And actually you're gonna see that I'm pretty neurotic. I collect a lot of tools. For instance, I think I've got maybe 10 full sets of propane regulators. And then over here it's all the stuff for riveting. And so there's an impact gun, we got a few of those. And then with those, we've got the bucking bars, so be on the back side of your rivets. We've got air drills, and if you've never run an air drill, you gotta try them, because this bad boy here spins up to 3,500 RPMs. Can't get that out of an electric drill. And then all the different, basically the bits, so cutting your different profiles, your rivets, be it a flush mount or a mounted rivet. And then we got the drill guides, so it allows you to drill 90 degrees, even when you're chasing through weird wings and stuff. So that's that. And then a little bit deeper into the mezzanine, got some big tools. So that's a 10-inch handheld wood saw. Got an impact drill here. This isn't the biggest bit, but that's 1.5 inches by 2 feet. So that's for when I go quarrying up in Minnesota to get some samples of rock. And then actually I have a dewar here for liquid nitrogen. So when you're installing huge bearings, you can actually shrink them by freezing them in that, drop them into place, the bearing heats up, and then bam, snug fit. This was a weird purchase. Just got this beast for $75. It's such a big turntable. I probably can make a turning house. So that's possibly a future project. This is an old experimental electric skateboard I designed and built, and it goes up to about 50 miles an hour. And because of that, I actually integrated a disc brake and then almost killed myself because the speed control was sticky. So it stuck on full speed. I slammed into a curb and then a building. So I've slowed down on that one. An oven for drying parts, an upholstery sewing machine. So this bad boy actually stitches 2 seams at once. So I only have one needle in it now, but it can do real thick leather with actually, it's 2 separate machines in one. I converted that to a brushless DC motor. It's like 1 horsepower, full variable speed. Pretty sweet. Here's a sewer snake. That's a 3/4 inch line, so I can actually use that to cut out roots. In fact, I think it still smells a little fresh. And then I have all my bandsaw stock, so I make my own bandsaw blades. Another little Bernina, old Swiss sewing machine. Backup drill press. I don't have all my chainsaws up. I've got my one concrete saw, but I'm currently milling a 30 inch diameter mesquite, so those are all out right now. Generator for backup. this pretty sweet. So this is a cutter master that it can actually sharpen not only drill bits and milling bits on the tip, but it can actually sharpen the entire spiral flute. And you put it, hook it up to a compressor, and then you've got that air bearing that's just total precision. And then that is a compressor that goes up to 4,500 PSI. So I'll either use that for scuba or making things go boom. And then right behind it is a water-cooled 300 amp spot welder for sheet metal. And then through there is a 6-ton winch. I hook that up to a tripod I built, and then I can actually use it to pick up trees or whatever. I can actually prevent a tree from falling on a house with the tripod and that winch, and then lower it down smoothly. And that is for basically turning brakes on the car, so you don't have to surface them using a different lathe. I think that's the entire mezzanine. All right, so stepping down, let's look beneath the mezzanine. So here's a 20-inch bandsaw. This one's pretty sweet. This is a Rockwell. And it can go from either 50 feet per second when you're doing some high carbon steel up to 4,500 feet per second doing wood or styrofoam even. You can actually see, I don't know if that'll focus, but it tells you how to cut everything with your cutting speeds and your blades necessary. It even has a bandsaw blade welder. I don't use that. I prefer to actually silver solder. It gives you better flexibility. It's not very brittle. And then solvents, bunch of hardware. That's a lot of stainless hardware, pipe threads, doing a bunch of plumbing. That's all aircraft hardware for nuts and bolts. This is my machinist toolbox. So it has a bunch of the stuff for doing all your precision. So calipers, and then your different 1, 2, 3 blocks, your V blocks. I can't open it because there's something in the way. And then this whole toolbox, this is pretty crazy. This whole toolbox is devoted to taps and dies. So if you ever needed a 2-inch tapered pipe tap or your standard pipe taps, got a little bit of everything. Then over here is an engine lathe. So that's the 15-inch Regal LeBlanc. And then with that, I got, you know, the three, four, and six jaw chucks with the rapid tool removal. And then underneath, that's all boring bars. A lot of this stuff I get at the scrap yard, and then I use that cutter master to sharpen them. Because you know you can't drill a round hole, you always have to go into it with a ream. So I have reams, you know, all the way down to probably a 32nd, up to 2-3 inches adjustable. And then beneath that is the whole 5C collet kit. And then over here, a lot of this stuff goes to the mill. So that is all high-speed milling bits. And I got all this at the scrapyard, no exaggeration, I think for 10 bucks. So people scrap it in the original containers. So I even have some in here that are diamond tipped. Maybe this is one, let's find out. Nope, that's not it. But that's why I go to the scrapyard every Saturday, like it's my church. Next drawer, this is all carbide. Once again, I can sharpen everything, including along the flute or just the tip, even the roundover bits. So pretty sweet having some sort of a sharpening jig. And then my different cutters for cutting slots and tapping jigs. So this you can hook up to the mill and then quickly run taps and cut threads fast. And then this is the mill, Bridgeport. So this is pretty cool. It's got the J head on the front, shaper on the back, so I can cut keyways or do some shaping. It's got both a swivel vise and a vertical rotary table that can actually lay horizontal. This has got an 8-inch chuck, and then I've got a 150-pound 12-incher back there if I have to turn some big stuff. This is kind of my toolbox. It's got all the wrenches and pliers, screwdrivers, blah, blah, blah. This is a steel table, cast iron, the vise, so I do a lot of my welding. It's got a drill press incorporated into it. You might get a kick out of this one, John. This one's for you. So this is my standard hardware drawer that has all my stainless and then standard rusty stuff. You ready for this, John? Drum roll. This is all titanium. That's a 1-inch aircraft wing bolt. But we get down to some smaller stuff. That's 3/8 all the way down to 1/8 and 1/16. I don't know if this is focusing, but this is my coveted drawer. It even has aluminum, aircraft rated aluminum bolts and nuts, and it gets weirder. It's another drawer of just junky parts. Some power tools, so electric die grinder, because pneumatic just kill the ears. All impact wrenches up to 1-inch drive. So that sucker, I can do a 3-inch nut with that. And believe it or not, the 6x6 uses some big nuts. It's got big nuts. Okay, and then power planes, so you can really hog off some wood. Pneumatic riveter, you know, blah blah blah. Porta band. This is pretty cool, the Tormex. So this does all my sharpening of the knives I used to make. So it has all of those attachments. So you can do knives, scissors, axes, you name it. You can sharpen it on the water wheel, and then you can actually hone it with the leather strop using diamond rouge. And then this slider here does planer and joiner blades. So that's a sweet system, all water cooled. This is a 10-inch grinder. So allows you to really hog off some metal. It's kind of scary though, those wheels flying. And over here, we got some more power tools. This is one of my new favorites. This is a drill press with an electromagnetic base. And so I've had some experience putting up metal buildings, and this is a dream. This can actually drill upside down and get perfect 90 degree holes. Normal, you know, small and big angle grinders, a little tight spot cutter, big frame nailer. This is really weird. This is a thin belt saw, handheld, belt sanding saw. This beast is a 16-inch Makita beam saw. So I use this for both cutting big wood beams, but I'll also put an abrasive and use it at the scrapyard for cutting off. I think I did an 8-inch propeller shaft. I needed the 316 stainless. And then more big grinder, normal wood saw, pneumatic grease, electric impact. And over here we got cutting torch, so oxyacetylene. And then this is kind of the base of my whole metal shop. So this is a, this synchro wave goes up to 400 amps, so I can stomp the pedal and weld aluminum blocks, you name it. I don't have to preheat. Chiller, this actually was used for chilling lasers, and then plasma cutter. And then over here we have the Power MIG 350. So this is Lincoln's spray transfer MIG welder, so it actually chops up the voltage and it atomizes the metal. And so if you're lazy, you can actually turn this thing on and you don't have to do any special movements. It's just a big and you just are done. I mean, it can really throw some metal. This is my little portable 100 amp. Sweet thing is with that 350, we've got this Cobra push-pull gun. So when you're running aluminum, you can either run the Miller little spool-matic that only takes a pound of material, or you can use this that actually has a pull motor, servo motor in the gun. And so you can run the huge 30-pound spools of aluminum and not worry about them kinking in the line, because this thing just keeps pulling it out smoothly. And when you dial this thing up to do aluminum or titanium or any of those, and it's doing that spray transfer, it actually sings like a siren. It's like, whoa! I mean, it's magic to your ears, John. I'm making these for a high pressure, high temperature petroleum experiment lab. So these are actually stands that will hold these experimental bombs that basically get put up to about 50,000 PSI and 700 degrees Celsius. And then you can run rock experiments, like basically look at molten rock and what happens within them with diffusion. This I also picked up with the other one. I think I got this with a Baldor DC turntable. I think I got that for $50 with the driver. And so I'm setting up a welding jig for that because I got this new weird gig where I gotta turn that into an 8-foot long liquid oxygen rocket fuel tank. So that is the small sausage version. Weld up the cylinders, hydroform it, test the hell out of it, and if it's safe, it's gonna be launched into outer space. You know probably as much as I do, if you're a maker, the clamps are God's gift. And so you can tell the clamp rack, this one weighs about 500 pounds full, has your wooden block clamps, then it has all your bar clamps from 6-inch up to 32, then it has your pipe clamps up to 6-foot, and then it has these weird Bessie bar clamps. You really allow you to torque the weight down. And then, I don't know if you can see it on the back side, but the back side is all C-clamps, and spring clamps. So from 1-inch up to your modest 2-foot. And I gotta put new wheels on it because the brand new caster wheels can't take the weight. Believe it or not, this is some of the stock that I wanna not get stolen. So that's all titanium tubing. Some 6061 aircraft aluminum. Down there are my specialty TIG and oxyacetylene rods from silicon copper to some weird alloys for repairing cast iron casings. And then here I've got my little portable hydraulic press for doing bearings and whatnot. This one only goes up to 10,000 PSI, but I've got outdoor ones that go up to 45,000. A little quarter scale model airplane I built. This is the Ford Flivver. It actually has a running 4-stroke on the front, so it has your little rocker arms and the valves. This is an aluminum, basically it's got T-slot on the back, and it's a solar panel, so these are glue-on solar cells, and my dad and I bought an entire solar array, so 500 of these for $500. And then we cut some aluminum off the back, making a buzzsaw. Not very safe, but we sold some of that scrap aluminum for $1,500. So we actually made $1,000. And then we're talking about actually using all those to make a fence around the whole yard. So this is pretty new. It's a low speed carbide metal saw. So it spins a lot slower than your abrasive chop saw. But then this is an idea that my dad and I've been working on where it's a chop saw table. But when you want to do metal, you're here. When you want to do wood, you actually pop the metal clamp, and then there's an actual wood chop saw. It's the Makita, because they're the best, underneath. And so, believe it or not, when you're ready, this sucker flips. So you have the wood chop saw, and then you flip it under when you want the metal saw. And then those outfeed tables are gonna flip up here on the sides, on both sides. So when you're rolling it around, it's narrow, but when you want to work on it, it folds out to be like 10 feet long. Powermatic belt sander and disc sander. Powermatic 6-inch wood joiner. Delta planer, 13-inch. And then you know, working with wood, that the heart of a wood shop is a table saw. So that's the Powermatic with a cast iron table. Got all the drawers for different blades and whatnot. So got even have the big forest data blade. I think that can cut up to 1-inch. All that stuff. And then got the sheet metal squaring shear, does 52 inches. And then got the large clawsing drill press, Morse taper 3 spindle. So it can do some pretty good sized drill bits. I'll show you those. Have a box and pan brake. This will do 48 inches. Behind that, we've got a Powermatic 90 wood lathe. You can tell it's not been installed yet. And then this is a Powermatic bandsaw, 20 inch like the other one, but I'm actually gonna slit out the throat and step it back so I can swing 36 inches inside the blade. So that's gonna be sweet for either resawing or working with some sheet metal. So that's all of those aluminum solar panels. And that right there is about 6 feet off the ground. It's all block of plywood. But you can see We have enough to do a solar fence. Pretty sweet. Next, this is all going to get moved outside now. Now that we've moved our semi-trailer in the yard. But watch the toes. So someday I hope to be able to swing that bit. That is 2¾ inches. It weighs almost 50 pounds. And I think it's a Morse taper 8. So I do not have a machine that'll swing that yet, but someday, John, big old radial drill press in the works. And then down here we have an old school, is it focusing? We have an old school Johnson horizontal bandsaw, and we have Kiba, the shop dog. He's actually not really a shop dog. What he does is he picks up any kind of plastic bottle and he puts them in front of your feet. So while you're working on a project, he does this and he drops it so you trip on it. And then he runs and gets it and he brings it back and then he puts it in your feet so you then trip over it again. So not a shop dog. In fact, if there's sparks or loud noise, he's the first thing out of here. And I think that's the tour, John. Lot of things in progress. So let me know what you think. Such a long video, I got to put it on YouTube. But I'll shoot you the link. Talk to you later, dude.